Hey PC World fans, Adam here with a review of the Intel Core i7-14700K, but I'm not alone. I am here with Dan Masaoka, a former employee here, now a freelance video editor, to come in and talk about what this new 14th gen part holds. You are current owner of a 13700K,
yep.
So I'm interested to hear your take on it. Before we get into that though, you might be asking yourself, where the hell is Gordon, and why am I the one doing the CPU review?
Yeah, Asian guy, Asian middle-aged man, but not bald.
Yeah, no, not the same guy. Definitely different. if you don't know, Gordon's on medical leave. I'm not going to get into the details here, but if you want to go back and watch an interview I did with him on our recent podcast, please go do so. There's a link up in the corner over here. In the meantime, I decided to fill in for Gordon because I've been able to understand and learn a lot over the years working with him about the process of CPU benchmarking. But also, even though he is on medical leave, he's been helping me out through this whole process. So even though he's not here and he's not the one who actually did the benchmarks, he was instrumental in actually making these benchmarks a reality. So
his greasy fingers are still a little bit a part of it.
It's true. Yeah. It's true. And he helped me contextualize all the numbers afterwards. So we are in lockstep for the most part on this. But yeah, hopefully he'll get better soon and come back and be able to do some more testing. In the meantime, I am here with the 14th gen CPUs, which for the most part are just a slight little variation off of 13th gen. Mm-hmm. This is a Raptor Lake refresh for the main Core i9 chip 5. We're talking about a clock bump. On the Core i7, which we're talking about here, it's not only just a clock speed bump, but it is also a 4 extra E cores. So we do have more cores, and those will play out in the testing that we have here. And it's kind of honestly the most interesting part of this Raptor Lake refresh lineup. For the questions of the chipset, any sort of PCIe lane differences, architectural differences, no, this is Raptor Lake refresh, but with advancements in the technology at the core of it, that is able to kind of have the higher clock speeds, the better power efficiency, things like that. So coming into it, 14th gen is pretty much just a refreshed 13th gen, nothing too exciting, but maybe you will get excited about this i7. I don't know, we'll get into it. Mm-hmm. Speaking of testing configurations, I had two identical boxes that were built from scratch. Thank you to Intel and AMD for providing all the hardware. AMD also provided the motherboard that was in that system. It was an ASRock X670E Tai Chi. Gigabyte provided the new Z790 refresh board, which is a Aorus Pro X, really nice motherboard, by the way. And Patriot sent over a ton of different RAM configurations, but in this configuration specifically, it was two identical kits of DDR5 6000 megatransfers per second. To round out the rest of the systems, I had MSI GeForce RTX 4090 Gaming X Trio cards. The CPUs were cooled with Corsair H150i Elite 360mm AIOs. For storage, I had identical 2TB Crucial T700 Gen 5 NVMe SSDs, but they were actually running in Gen 4 speeds. I ran into some problems, but even though these are Gen 5 drives, they're configured at Gen 4 speeds. Powering both of the systems, Silverstone was nice enough to provide matching Hella 1300R Platinums. All of the hardware was thrown in identical Corsair 4000D Airflows, but the side panels were off on all of them to get as much of an open test bench feel as I could. In terms of software configuration, both of them were running Windows 11 22H2 with all the latest drivers. The Z790 motherboard was running off of BIOS F3, and the X670E BIOS was 1.29.AS01. For what that matters. Both of them, the PL1 and PL2, actually most of the configuration like PBO and MCE, it was all set to auto. I go into the kind of the testing methodologies in the latest episode of The Full Nerd, but we wanted it to have it as much real world scenario as possible, and these motherboards are going to push these chips to the absolute extreme. So we left it in the default auto setting. Within Windows, the only thing other, I mean, it was a fresh Windows install, but I did delete some of the bloat, Teams, OneDrive, things that would kind of run in the background and affect any of the numbers. Oh, and the last one is VBS was turned off on both of them. Both systems actually installed it differently. On the Intel system, I believe it defaulted to VBS on, where the AMD system defaulted to it off. I can't remember exactly, but to have parity, both of them were set to off. So if you want to hear more about the configuration and the testing methodology, definitely go back and listen to the full nerd. We go really in depth on here. I'm not going to get more deep into it here. Also, if you want to see the review of the 14900K, there's a link to it in the video player right here. So the results of the i9 and the Ryzen 9 are going to be in here, but we're mostly going to contextualize the information that we're seeing for the i7. So we're going to start off with rendering workloads. And we like to start off around these parts, Dan, with Cinebench R23. This first chart right here is single-threaded performance. And we can see that from the 13700K to the 14700K, we get a nice increase in single-threaded performance here. I mean, it's okay. It's not a ton.
5%?
Yeah, but I don't know the actual percentage, but it does calculate with the clock speed bump that we're getting, and actually puts us right in line with the 13900K. So essentially, you know, you're getting the benefits of the what was the i9 part, now down to the i7. As Gordon would always say, bigger bar is better. So this is a good generational uplift for the i7 part. If we switch over to multi-threaded workloads, that's where the magic is, because the 14700K has four additional E-cores. And you might be saying, those are E-cores. Just throw those out. Those suck. But actually, in multi-threaded workloads like this, they can be beneficial. We can see a very, very good bump from 13700K to 14700K. That is a very big generational increase, and something that we did not see with the i9 part, because there was no extra cores, and that motherboard with the unlimited PL1, PL2 was definitely pushing both of them as hard as they could. The 14700K now starts to play a little bit closer to that Ryzen 9, more specifically that X3D part, and definitely eats the lunch of the 12-core 7900X. That's around the same price on the AMD side. If you're not rendering stuff in Cinebench, maybe you're rendering in a Blender. So this is a Blender workload. We've got three different scenes that it renders out. And once again, where the i9s generationally was not getting a huge uplift, and it was pretty much within margin of error, that i7 part is turning in a much, much better score.
Yeah.
And in every single one of these scenarios, still beats out the 7900X that is around the same price street. Obviously, deals change, availability in certain parts of the world, whatever, but I'm going to compare it a lot to the 7900. I'm going to compare it a lot to the 7900X, because here in the US, I just looked it up on Newegg, it's around the same price. So, but once again, AMD actually does have traditionally a benefit in Blender. If we can see for the Core i9 and the Ryzen 9, AMD is definitely having the bigger advantage there. But down at the i7 and the 7900X, Intel takes a little bit of a lead here.
Interesting.
One last multi-threaded workload, and we have V-Ray 5. Here, once again, traditionally at the i9 level, AMD with the all big cores beats out the Core i9, even the newest 14 Gen 1. But when we look down at the i7, it is starting to, once again, paint that picture of, hey, more cores, even though they're E-cores, is definitely beating that 7900X, and is a great generational uplift from that 13700K. Let's move into content creation and start off with Handbrake.
Okay.
We're doing a 4K video transcode. If you want to know the actual details of the transcode, because I'm not going to go over every option that we use in our benchmark here, I'm going to put that in the description, go in the video description and kind of look at the details here. But it is a 4K video transcode. This is measured in seconds, so shorter bar better.
Yeah.
And we can see that the 13700K turned in 261 seconds. In the same transcode, the 14700K turned in 234 seconds. So,
yeah, that's decent. That's like kind of splitting the difference.
It's like 30 seconds.
Yeah, you know, but it's like, you know, like I just rendered a video that was like, you know, a 3-hour presentation. Mm-hmm. So when you start talking about these super long videos, you know, that 30 seconds, you know, could become, you know, 10 minutes. Good. So it matters a little bit.
And either way, the Intel parts are definitely more favored in this handbrake test. Mm. But let's move over to Premiere Pro, something you use to edit.
Yeah.
This is Puget Bench 0.98. And I will say that this benchmark has changed recently. I wanted to do a deeper dive video with Gordon about it, but they have taken any sort of benchmark out that pertains to real-time playback, which is a bummer for me. They say that they took it out because they didn't feel like it was consistent enough in run-to-run variations. So I'm going to have to trust them on that. But at least for video editing, for me, I don't know about you, but I worry more personally about scrubbing and playing back and editing the video than I do rendering, because usually I just set it to render and then go do something else. What about you?
Yeah, I mean, I think at least for the playback, it's either works or it doesn't work, right? It's either lagging or it's stuttering or it's not. So it's like, for me, as long as it works, then it works. But I would say it also matters between, like, you know, are you doing heavier graphic and complex stuff for a shorter video, in which case the export probably won't matter as much, but your playback experience does matter, you know, because you're scrolling around, you're scrubbing, doing all kinds of stuff. But then if you're just doing light stuff but editing long videos, it's a very different experience.
True. I mean, because we do kind of a mixture here. Yeah. I mean, I'm not saying we do a ton of, like, graphical stuff, but yeah, we've got, shorter videos, but then we got, like, a long podcast that I need to transcode in a couple different ways for the CMS and the RSS feed and things like that. So, no, I totally get that. Well, looking at the results, Intel, in every single one of these chips, even the 13700K, beats out AMD. And if we look at the subscores, it all pretty much comes down to one, which is LongOp. So in the LongOp performance, Intel has an advantage. And I don't know exactly why. It could be taking advantage of the IGP
here.
Or maybe it's just, hey, it doesn't matter how many or what kind of cores, but it just needs more cores. Maybe that's where it's coming from. I'm not quite sure. But if you are somebody who edits in LongOp, which we do here at PC World for what we do, we edit in LongOp, and that is traditionally more CPU intensive because of it has to decompress those files. So everything else that they have in here, Intraframe, RAW, and even the GPU effect score, slight variations, and it kind of depends, but LongOp specifically is where they're picking up the win.
I mean, that's where I usually edit in too. Just, keeps down on storage space. Otherwise, and then it's like you have to buy more media cards if you're shooting Intraframe, and I don't do RAW, so my cameras don't do RAW. So, I mean, for me, it's like that's, I don't know, I think that's probably where I think most people are.
I would think so. I mean, and once again, it depends. If you want to go see the details of the files that they use for this benchmark, you can go check it out on their website. But they do use a couple different kinds of codecs. So
makes sense. Yeah,
it definitely does. It matters the codec. Mm-hmm. It matters the size. This is the extended benchmark, so this does include 4K and 8K footage. So maybe 1080p is not that big of a deal. So maybe this is really coming down to like 8K. Kind of stuff. I don't know. But, I mean, what we always say with these CPU reviews is that, hey, look at the workload that you're interested in, and make a determination off of that. Just because in the overall extended score, Intel wins doesn't necessarily mean that is the clear choice. You have to, that's why we kind of bust out these subscores. So, moving over to photo, which you do some photography.
Yeah.
This is the newest version of Lightroom Classic. And, you know what? They're not really seeing too much differentiation between all of these chips. Obviously, that 7800X3D with 8 cores is just having a hard time keeping up. But if you see in the subscores, that really comes down to the passive. So active is actually moving around in the edit panel and making changes. Passive is queuing up a bunch of photos to batch export, right? So, and here we can see that, to a certain degree, it comes down to how many cores you have. But really, I mean, if you think about it, that 8-core 7800X3D is actually keeping up pretty good, considering it's 8 cores, but it's also 8 cores with 3D V-cache, so they're actually clocked a little bit lower. So for photo editing, at least in Lightroom Classic, I mean, I think for the most part, you're going to be fine. with any of these chips.
Yeah, really. I mean, I don't do anything that hardcore to be like, I think I would notice a difference. Mm-hmm. Do you, what, like, who would notice a difference? Like, what are you doing that's like, oh, this matters? Like, this difference matters.
I mean, I guess if you have plugins, right? I mean, that can affect it. The type of files you're using. So you can look up Puget Bench what kind of files that they have in here. They have kind of a mixture of like 5D Mark III and things like that. So they do have a couple different kind of camera files in here to mess around with. And they put it through some paces in different ways. But yeah, I mean, for the most part, I mean, if you here's another way to think about it. The difference between paying for the Core i9 versus the i7 is not that big of a jump if you're mostly doing photo editing. An i7, I think, is going to be fine. Or if you're like, oh, you know what, I kind of want to have AMD and I kind of want to have that 3D V-cache, yes, you're going to take a little bit of a hit, but what you come up with in gaming might offset it. Speaking of photos, the last one for content creation is Photoshop here, the newest version. And honestly, there's no one specific subcategory that just wins. It just kind of like, you know, trails off depending on the chip. So yeah, you're getting that uplift of the i7 to last generation's i9, at least in here. And in every case, Intel is better than AMD. So speaking of real world, now let's move over to some productivity benchmarks. There is a lot of debate on how useful some of these productivity benchmarks are, but it is kind of a good at least snapshot into, hey, what is it like to use a desktop and not push it to the bleeding edge like a rendering program would. So the first one here is Babco's Crossmark. Goes through a range of tasks and bundles it into productivity, creativity, and responsiveness. And then spits out an overall score. And we can see in creativity and responsiveness specifically, Intel has a very, very commanding lead, and then productivity, you know, kind of just scales a little bit with core count. Either way, Crossmark definitely favors Intel. It just kind of depends. And if we're looking at the i7 versus last year's i9, once again, it kind of falls in place and is better than the last year's i7 as well. Theoretically, what this is saying is that, you know, just general day-to-day workload kind of stuff, it's gonna favor Intel, at least in this benchmark. Let's move over to Web Expert, which is run in Google Chrome, and we can see, yes, all the Intel chips turn in a better score than the AMD chips, but, you know, I think you'd really have to sit down and be like, wow, Google Chrome is much snappier in this other CPU than the other. So I don't know exactly how useful it is.
Maybe if you're a competitive gamer through a streaming game.
I don't know. A web-based through the web browser.
Competitive gamer.
I don't know. I don't think they really test it in this one, but I think it's more like, hey, you know, how much behind is an i3 versus an i9 kind of thing. If you're talking about, I mean, these are all above $400 CPUs. In web browsing, you're probably going to be fine. But technically, Intel wins. So, and then the last one is one that Gordon wanted me to do. It's what he dubs the official benchmark of Twitter arguments. That is none other than Geekbench. I'm not going to spend a ton of time here, but Intel wins on that i9, both in single core and multi-core. Mm-hmm. But when we're talking about compared to the 14700K versus the 7900X, single core is actually trailing a little bit, even though it does have that clock bump. But multi-core, it turns in a better score. Yeah. So take these scores, go argument on Twitter. You know, use these official scores to settle whatever kind of bets you have. All right, so now let's move on to the last major section, and that is gaming performance. You know, I don't think it's going to be much of a stretch to say that the landscape doesn't really change too much because a lot of games don't use all those extra cores. So really, we're talking about either clock speed increases, benefits from there, or the 3D V-cache. And none of it is shown off better than in Shadow of the Tomb Raider here. So yes, because of that clock speed increase, the i7 14700K definitely does turn in more frames.
11 more frames.
Yeah, than that 13700K. But either way, this game specifically loves that 3D V-cache. So even that 8-core 7800X 3D is turning in like, you know, over 60 more frames, which is substantial.
Yeah, I mean, it would be irrelevant on my monitors, so.
Yeah, there you go. Moving on to another game, this time we have Tom Clancy's Rainbow Six Siege. We definitely see an increase, very slight, but I would say this is kind of margin of error. Yeah, between the two i7s. Same thing with the i9s. But once again, we see that this game definitely likes that V-cache. But, I mean, if we're just to compare the Core i7 14700K to the Ryzen 9 7900X, it is turning in almost 40 extra frames. Once again, it's up at the 600 already. Yeah. So, you know, we're talking about a small percentage, but technically it is faster. But we have a couple more games left. This next one is Total War Warhammer 3. And I actually ran two of the benchmarks that were in there because this is an Intel-sponsored game, and they were showing a very large increase over any of the AMD processors, and I wanted to know which benchmark exactly that they were using to show. So I ran two of them here, and you can see in the battle benchmark, it actually turns in some weird results. It actually kind of goes backwards, that the top end chip is slower than the bottom end 13th gen chip. But the thing that I saw in the battle benchmark is that it was actually very inconsistent run to run, and I think that really comes down to like physics and things like that. So I actually don't feel like this battle benchmark is a good indication
of
performance.
It's the RNG. Yeah. Like something died that wasn't supposed to die.
Yeah, I'm not sure what happened. So I switched over to the campaign benchmark. And the campaign benchmark, in every single scenario, the Intel chip beats out AMD. And it definitely beats the 7950X3D. But it did not beat the 7800X3D. So I'm not exactly sure why that 7800X3D did so much better in this benchmark than the 7950X3D.
Very weird.
But either way, in this campaign benchmark, Intel does have a win there. All right, a couple more games left here, and then we'll wrap it up. This one is Watch Dogs Legion, and surprise, surprise, this title loves 3D V-cache. We are seeing some very big gains in these two 3D V-cache parts that we have listed here. But for the i7, we are seeing a little bit of an increase. So, you know, that extra little clock bump is helping somewhere, but it just cannot keep up in this title. Thanks to that 3D V-cache. I did the Final Fantasy 14 benchmark. I actually ran this one in both 1080p and 4K, just because I wanted to kind of see the scaling between resolutions. Because typically you think, hey, at 4K, you're going to be more GPU bound than CPU bound. At 1080p, you're going to be more CPU bound than GPU bound, typically. So I ran it here, and what we see is that while at 1080p, we can kind of see a nice scaling between the Intel parts. At 4K, for the most part, it just kind of evens out. The 3D V-cache parts kind of, you know, come up, and the non-3D V-cache parts are a little bit lower, but we're talking about, you know, high, almost 200 FPS on all those at 4K. So, yeah, I'm not seeing a huge benefit here to either of the sides. And the last one I wanted to run was Cyberpunk 2077.
Okay.
I ran this one specifically in overdrive mode, which is their high-end path tracing, fully, RT and shadows and lighting and stuff like that. So very intensive. But I decided to run it without upscaling, without frame gen. I thought personally that running it even without those were going to show a big difference in performance, because a lot of that path tracing stuff is pretty dependent on the CPU. I was kind of wrong. Everything here is within margin of error. I think next time I run this, I will run this with upscaling at least to kind of, you know, maybe take a little bit more of that GPU bottleneck out. But we're not learning too much here.
But at least we're starting to get into FPS that I think numbers that matter to me. Because like now, like in the range of 70 frames per second, you would notice a difference. And then when you have 200 frames per second, even if you get 50 more frames, are you going to notice?
I would say some people would say yes.
I'm going to say people will say yes, but I'm going to say they can't.
Okay. Yeah, hey, here's the thing. TLDR on the gaming stuff is that there's literally thousands of games out there, and it's hard to make a overall determination of like, oh yeah, this one's always better in games than the other one. It really comes down to the kind of games you play, how often you play those games. I'm somebody who likes to dabble in a bunch of little games. Yeah. You're somebody who really games like on one game for years. Yeah. So it's kind of hard to make a determination. I would say generally, esports kind of titles like single-threaded, really high clock speeds, where you know there's some games that just love V-Cache, and we saw that in here. So I would say there's a couple different ways to look at it. If you're looking just for a gaming CPU, then I would probably say, hey, you know, go for as good as you can get for the CPU and put more money into the GPU, because that's really where you're going to see the difference.
So,
but if you're somebody who is like you, who does some gaming, but then also needs to rely on it for work, then those extra cores might be more beneficial to you. And even though you don't get the benefit of the 3D V-Cache in gaming, you at least make up for it in work. I don't know.
So when you say that matters, would you be recommending a gamer go down to the 13.5? An
i5? So I haven't tested the i5 yet. That's what I'm going to be testing next. So, I mean, we'll kind of see how that plays out here. But here's the other thing. I actually didn't do a ton of game testing. There's a lot of people on YouTube and reviewers who have done a ton of game testing. Go over and watch that stuff. I actually just personally care more about the work end of it because I care less about the CPU when it comes to gaming than I do the GPU. I don't know. Once again, for me, it's just it's hard to dig too deep into it and see the benefit. I've seen, at least anecdotally, plenty of people being like, hey, you know what? I got an i3 and I'm gaming just fine at the desired resolution and frame rate. Mm-hmm. So it is so context specific that it is hard to put kind of an easy number on it for me.
Yeah.
Where if we're talking about work,
and
we can say, hey, you know what? This one's gonna render faster than this one. Like, that's an appreciable difference.
Yeah, a real jump. And, you know, I've always thought the 13.7 was a chip for if you're buying your own computer and you're working on it. You know, the i9 is when someone else is paying for it. You know, the i7 is, it's hitting that sweet spot where you still get, you know, quite a bit of performance, but you're paying for your, you know, it's like $200. That's $200 that could be in your pocket. You know, there's a difference.
It's true, yeah. And now seeing these numbers, I definitely feel like the improvements for 14th gen here over 13th gen is a really nice jump.
It's a real jump,
I think I agree with you. It's not, hey, upgrade from a 13700 jump. But if you were looking price for price, I think it's obvious. I feel like you'd really have to kind of like be like, oh, okay, well, I see the 13700 and it's on sale for like $100. Okay, maybe that's something worth considering, you know, that kind of difference. But it depends on what you do with it and the rest of the budget you have for the build. It kind of comes down to that. The last part of this equation is power usage. Obviously, the 13900K, you can go back and watch that video. That thing will guzzle a lot of power to get a lot of performance. I will say it's actually not too different for the i7 version here. And yes, if we're looking pound for pound, the i7 versus the 7900X, yes, it turns in better scores, but it uses more power to do it, especially on multi-threaded workloads. On single-threaded, usually, P core versus big core on the AMD systems. Intel has a little bit of an advantage over there, but you know, I think it depends on how much you care about power, how much you care about thermals, because the more power you use, the hotter the system is going to get. How much do you care about power and thermals?
I mean, we're in California, where power is probably the most expensive in the country, but maybe in the lower 48.
Okay,
but I don't care. Like, I'm an adult, so I don't have my parents paying for electricity. So I'm paying for it, but I care zero about it.
Well, what about how it translates to heat? Because I know you said you've been feeling the heat come off of that system.
That's true, but I don't know if it's a GPU.
True.
Create all that heat versus the CPU.
True.
And if I knew for a fact that, like, over the course of the year, you know, it's costing me $50 more in electricity,
mm-hmm.
then that actually might mean something, you know, but...
Which it very well could.
But if we're talking five, you know, what are we talking? $5? $20? $100? You know, like that's the number that I want to hear someone tell me is like, oh, you could actually be saving. Because then, you know, that price difference in a GPU might matter. But then it kind of comes back down to if you're doing this for work, it's like, you know, who cares that it costs you $50 more over the course of the year? You were that much, yeah, that much more performance. And so it's like, you know, sometimes time is money.
Yeah, no, true, definitely. I mean, it once again, it comes down to the situation and what people are willing to put up with cost wise. Generally, overall, the AMD chips are more efficient than the Intel chips. But it also depends on how often you're going to do those really heavy workloads that are going to stress the whole system. And at that point, maybe you're putting all the load on the GPU anyway, so it doesn't...
And then in the winter, you want the heating. It's icily. You're like, oh, I'm in my office. I don't want to cool the whole house.
It's a benefit.
It's a benefit. I'm just heating up my room.
Yeah, well, my late cat BB loved to sit on top of my Intel system because it was nice and warm. And so it was a benefit.
You can't put a price on that joy, that happiness.
Yeah, you can't put a price on that.
So,
okay. So to conclude, to put some final thoughts. Once again, overall, 14th gen is kind of okay. It's just Raptor Lake refresh. Honestly, I think what it comes down to is that when I talked to Gordon, he was like, "Hey, you know what? You can't roll into 2024 without that new car smell." So you know, somebody at Intel was like, "Hey, you know what? We need to get some better chips on the market here. Oh, do we have Arrow Lake ready? No, we don't. Okay, well, what kind of benefits can we get from some increases in Raptor Lake? Okay, well, we get a little benefit. Why not call that a new generation and put it out there and spur some more sales?" That's kind of what it sounds like it happened here.
Yeah, but with the i7 specifically, those four efficiency cores do give a real benefit.
Definitely. This is definitely the one shining spot in 14th gen that is an appreciable difference. How much of a difference? I mean, it's not huge, but it depends on what you do.
Yeah.
It could make a huge difference for gaming, not really, but for very heavy workloads, it looks like there can definitely be a benefit.
Yeah, I mean, it kind of split the difference. If like here was the i7 and here was the i9, the new i7 kind of splits the difference. Is based on the benchmarks.
For multi-threaded stuff.
Yeah.
No, I would tend to agree with that. Either way, even though there's no new chipset advantages, also there are Z790 refresh boards out from all the major manufacturers. I use this Gigabyte board specifically, but I have looked into like the new ASUS boards that are out there, and there are reasons to upgrade or look at this for the generational increases. Things like Wi-Fi 7, Thunderbolt 5 is now available on these newer platforms. So there is enough to look and kind of be interested in, but also, who knows, maybe 13th gen, you're going to start seeing some really good fire sales on those parts, and you might have to make more of a calculated decision. But, I mean, if we're talking on street pricing, you know, it once again depends on where you live. But if we're talking about MSRP, these are pretty much the same price, and I don't see a reason not to go with 14th gen.
Yeah.
It is more power efficient than 13th gen, and also you do get some benefits, especially here at the i7 level.
Yeah.
So that is my review for now. I will start testing the i5 and hopefully have that review up next week. I do want to thank Gordon once again for having my back this whole way during this testing process. I definitely couldn't have done it without him, so I appreciate that. I also reached out to Steve from Gamers Nexus, and he answered a lot of my questions, and Ian. I even asked Dr. Ian Cutchers from Tech Potato a couple questions as well. So I feel like I had some of the greatest benchmarkers at my back to help me walk through this setup, and it was fun. Thank you for sitting down and walking through this and kind of contextualizing it as the everyman.
The i7 is like, that's where I live.
You're an i7 kind of guy?
Yeah, I had the 8700 before that.
Oh, nice. Know? Okay, so. Yeah, you're an i7 kind of guy. I like it.
Yeah.
And thank you for watching. You know, I think through the process of these benchmarks, you know, I was definitely curious to see what people thought of them. If you have a benchmark that you would like to see integrated in this test suite or maybe configured a little bit differently, let me know. I'm definitely open to that feedback. But either way, thank you for watching, and be sure to subscribe here on PC World for more PC hardware and software goodness. We will check you out in the next video.